Good morning, all, and welcome to the, the April 9th meeting of the Board of Regional Commissioners. And the only topic on our agenda today is we're going to have a discussion about the nuclear power plant, the Pilgrim plant, located in the town of Plymouth, and its impacts on the Cape Cod community as a whole. And so I thought, well, I do have to start the meeting appropriately, since it is a meeting, and that is with the Pledge of Allegiance. So if you will just join us, the flag is over there. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And please join us in a moment of silence as we remember all the men and women who serve in our armed forces, both here and abroad, and especially for those who have given their lives for us. Thank you. And if there is anyone here who wishes to speak on your public comment, I don't see anyone. So we'll move right on to our agenda for the day. And that is to discuss a petition that has come from Cape Town Winders regarding the Pilgrim plant and what actions the county commissioners might take regarding the petition. So I think we'll start off with Diane Turco. And you have a presentation,
yes,
and you can probably share some very good thoughts with us about all the issues that you've been involved with over the past many, many months.
Okay. And I want to thank the commissioners for attending to this very most serious and urgent issue. And our goal today is that the commissioners consider adopting a resolution calling for the Nuclear Regulatory Commission to close the Pilgrim reactor because of public safety cannot be assured. So hopefully after this quick slideshow, we'll be able to make that case for you.
Okay.
Okay?
Fine.
Oops. Okay. This is quick. There's not 40 slides. Don't be worried. There. But I'm Diane Turkle with Cape Town Winders, and there's other great Cape Town Winders here. 2 years ago, we had a big question regarding the nuclear power plant, and our question is, can public safety be assured? You know, our elected officials are accountable for public safety, and that was our question. And let me just give you a little bit of background about the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. They have designated two emergency planning zones. The first one is the inhalation pathway. In the event of an accident, if radioactive particles are released into the air, the danger is, as they say, is inhaling the particles. It can cause severe injury and death. And this is a 10-mile emergency planning zone. And the plan for the 10-mile emergency planning zone is to evacuate, to get away from the exposure to the plume, all right? Outside of there, it's called the shadow evacuation, and that's 10 to 15 miles away. This shadow evacuation came up after Three Mile Island. At the time in 1979, they didn't realize, I mean, the industry said there won't be accidents, we really don't need emergency planning. But after Three Mile Island, there was a realization that, yes, in fact, people need to be protected. The governor asked pregnant women and children to leave the area, and over 100,000 people left, up to 100 miles away. So it was chaos. So the NRC looked at the shadow evacuation, and they say that's only 10 to 15 miles. That what's going to happen if they have to evacuate the 10 miles, what's going to happen in the 10 to 15 when people are getting in their cars and trying to escape? The NRC says there really isn't going to be any issue with that. Okay, according to the AGO, the NRC is negligent in really responding to the shadow evacuation. But that covers the bridges, that covers Sandwich, parts of Sandwich and Bourne. And then we have the ingestion pathway zone, which is 10 to 50 miles out. And the Nuclear Regulatory Commission identifies this area as the radioactive particles are going to fall out of the air and land on the ground, and you're going to eat that tomato or kick it up on the grass and breathe it in. I mean, eat it. Like, how did it get there in the first place? We're gonna all hold our breaths for like 10 days, you know? It's still, you're gonna be exposed, but they call it the ingestion pathway zone. And in this area, they say shelter in place, or don't wash your vegetables, okay? But the air is gonna be contaminated, and so will the soil and the land. So there's a lot of negligence in this planning. And as you see, and as I hope I can show you, is so all these plans do is provide support for the industry to continue operating at our risk. and it's public, it's profit over public safety. All right, any questions on this part? Okay, and also too, in Japan, after Fukushima, the United States government asked 50 miles to be evacuated by of American citizens.
Yeah, I guess I do have a question, if you don't mind.
Okay.
The, you mentioned Three Mile Island. I haven't been in that plant, and that was when I was working in corrosion control. And at that time, it had been about, I guess, about 11 or 12 years since the event. At that time, they were very clear that there had been no evidence of any physical harm or affect of, to anybody that lived within that area that you're speaking about. And of course, as you know, that's close to Harrisburg, which is a, you know, which is the state capital and is, you know, is a large area. I just bring that up to sort of give a perspective as to an event that happened and an outcome, and the, unfortunately, there was no what I would call residual effects at that particular, in that particular event. The issue that was brought up while I was in working in the plant was that they were concerned about Legionnaires' disease, which is another thing that's, you know, that's down in the Philadelphia area. For some reason, it's in Pennsylvania, but it doesn't appear up here. I just wanted to bring that up.
There's controversy. There's a lot of controversy. I mean, it was out of court case that was settled for millions and millions of dollars. So there's a lot of controversy. But if I could just get back to the emergency planning, is the governor said, get out of there. And if our governor said that, what would happen? Yes, yes, okay. Next slide. All right, so we identified three areas that we want people to understand that there's a risk, an imminent risk, is it's a General Electric Mark I containment failed design. This was designed in the 50s and 60s. It was built in the 70s. When it was built, they realized that the containment structure was too small for the reactor vessel. So they ended up putting vents in it. These are the same Mark I boiling water reactors that blew in Fukushima. It's the same reactor. It has high density nuclear waste right there on the site. The pool of the waste is up in the attic of the building outside the main containment structure. It is surrounded by concrete, but the top is a metal sheet roof. Okay? It was designed to hold 880 assemblies. But what happened was, because there was no national repository, the NRC changed the regulations to allow the industry to keep stuffing these spent fuel rods, highly radioactive spent fuel rods, into the pool. It now holds over 3,200, and it cannot hold any more. And that's why Entergy is building the dry cask storage, because it would have to close because there's no more room in that waste pool according to the adapted NRC regulations. All right. Dr. Gordon Thompson did a study for the Attorney General's office that said this is an imminent danger to the public. If a fire ever started, because these are so tight, if the water drained, there'd be a spontaneous fire that could not be put out. 24,000 latent cancers, $488 billion in damages, and hundreds of miles downwind contaminated. All right, he did that study, Dr. Thompson did that study for the relicensing. All right, cancer rates, four times closer the nearer you get to the reactor. Dr. Richard Clapp just testified that, yes, if Pilgrim shut down, the incidence of cancer would be reduced. All right, so this is a cancer machine in our community. And then tritium's been leaking for years and years. I asked a nuclear regulatory commissioner, well, what about the tritium, commissioned staff? What about the tritium? Oh, don't worry about the tritium. Well, it's leaking into our bay. What's that doing, okay? The NRC, oh, there's no reasonable assurance of evacuation. Chief Duxbury Fire Chief Kevin Nord testified at the trial of the Pilgrim 14 that there's no reasonable assurance for public safety in the town of Duxbury. That's a violation of the Nuclear Regulatory Commission mandate, federal oversight mandate. All right, so that's right there, right 6 miles away. They can't assure public safety. The NRC has determined that Pilgrim is the ninth worst operating reactor in the country. It has more shutdowns than any other reactor in the country. The Pentagon has determined in a study that it is the eighth most vulnerable to a terrorist attack from the water. Okay? The Academy of Sciences has determined that there is no safe dose of radiation. Okay, so the operation of a nuclear power plant produces radioactive materials, and release of those materials into the environment is part of the operation. Ongoing damage to Cape Cod Bay. The cooling system sucks in
510
million gallons of water a day and shoots it back out 30 degrees hotter, entrapping millions of fish larvae. The NRC nor Entergy Corporation actually appreciate these risks because it's a profit-making corporation. And that's why we're coming to the county commissioners to bring your voices together with the 15 towns and the governor who have said, this is a danger and it's a serious risk to the citizens. Okay, the second one is that the Pilgrim Nuclear Power Plant was relicensed for 20 more years over the objection of the governor, the attorney general, Senator Wolf, Representative Keating, Senator Markey. Many, many people said don't relicense until public health and safety concerns were addressed. And the NRC totally ignored all of that and relicensed Pilgrim. All right, so here again, what's happening in our democratic society? Where is the people saying our public health and safety? It's a basic human right, I think. And then the last thing is there is no escape from the Cape. We know that already. We've been told by MEMA, you're not leaving. And I have just a short clip of Kurt Schwartz saying that to you, okay? Any questions on this? Okay, so this is quickly, this is a map. This pink area is a radioactive release from Fukushima within the first 24 hours, superimposed over Pilgrim. Okay, it stretches all the way down to Long Island, covering into Providence, all the way up to Boston, all right? The NRC has plans for the 10 miles, but we know that's not what happens when the wind is blowing.
Which way does the wind blow?
It blows southwest.
Yeah,
but it changes.
Okay, the prevailing wind is?
Southwest.
In which direction is that from the Cape?
From the Cape? Or towards
south, southwest.
Southwest.
So it's blowing.
So that's why it's going down
west.
Towards New York area.
So the wind pattern you're saying is similar to Fukushima in terms of the direction it goes
on that
in?
Given day. Yeah. That's
no, actually, I think what we're saying here is that radiation is going to go. Here's a 10 mile EPZ. Mm-hmm. You know, the NRC says we only have to plan within 10 miles for exposure. That's the 10 miles there, and this illustrates that it's beyond 10 miles. I mean, we know that in Fukushima that the cesium is going around the world now.
Right, and also, I mean, if you looked at this, say on a given day this happens, mm-hmm. and now the wind is a certain way, those colors may be turned around a little bit, but the density of them would be pretty much the same. And it's also giving an example of how it spreads because it's carried in the air, whether it's, within 10 miles. I mean, you can see where some sections aren't as strong, but some sections are that go up past Maine into Canada of a direct gas, being carried, but then the rest is being sort of dissipated over this whole area.
Right, exactly. And what's in the spent fuel pool, the cesium, 137, is more than... Somebody correct me, it's more than all the nuclear weapons cesium that has been, yes, it's
so
huge.
Clarify, on this map you're saying on that day the wind was going southwest, or is
not
that the way our winds usually are?
No, we're not, this isn't about the wind, this
right.
is about
I know. Just
I
the,
think,
the way it carries.
I think it's clear to say that this, at the time the Fukushima accident occurred, and in the surrounding times, that's what happened based on atmospheric conditions at the time and at that place.
Right.
It's totally different here, but it shows what could happen because it's a plant very similar.
And it also illustrates
expanse of the radiation.
And it's been reported that was a lucky day for that to happen because most of it was blowing out over the Pacific Ocean.
Mm-hmm.
So the variables are, have to always be considered as far as a large nuclear disaster is.
One thing about the wind, I mean, our prevailing winds are southwesterly from the southwest. But I think that Pilgrim is most vulnerable during a severe weather event like a northeaster. And then the winds are blowing from the northeast down to Cape Cod, or from a northerly direction right down to Cape Cod.
I'm not diminishing the concern that we should have. I just remember people are saying this, and we don't want to unnecessarily raise a level of panic with regard to a response. Okay, we do have God has given us this opportunity to look at this and discuss it. when we go forward, I think there has to be some rational content in the response that we have to it.
I think we did that.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. So this is how, actually how we got started. We had a Mother's Day rally at the bridge, and we had our signs, "No Escape from the Cave." But the Massachusetts Emergency Management Agency came back and said, that couldn't be further from the truth. There'd be free-flowing traffic over the bridges. What are you people talking about? Right. So we said, well, okay, if you're saying that, if we're confused, share the information so we can make an informed decision. Well, they wouldn't share it for a while. We had to press and press to get the book. So we finally got the book, and this is one of the maps in the book. This is Route 6 going west towards the bridge. This is Route 30 exit 2. And as you see, the traffic is blocked. It says movement facilitated, movement discouraged. They specifically used that language so as not to panic people to say closed, okay? But that's what they're doing, they're blocking this.
They're basically rerouting you back to your own destination again.
I asked, what happens when people get off Route 130? Well, we don't know. So I contacted the fire chief and police chief in Sandwich and said, do you know about this map and what will be happening? They had no idea about this. Same thing in Bourne. Gave them the map, they had no idea. Yeah.
This map is from the Cape Cod traffic plan?
No, this is from the MEMA Entergy Emergency, Pilgrim Emergency Plan. I have the book in my car, actually, I should have brought it in. But this is from the MEMA Entergy book that we got. It's about this thick, and it's got maps for all the towns. We also found that they had mislabeled maps. There was a map that was in Bourne that was labeled as Sandwich. They also had tags, like these are where the emergency people are supposed to go. They had a tag that the map had it on one side of the canal, and then the map, instructions were on the other side, having them go to two different places on either side of the canal. They're supposed to be reviewed every year, but again, too, this kind of is evidence that these are paper plans that are just meant for Entergy to have their operating license and have nothing to do with public safety, because they had no idea what was going to happen after this map was shown, all right? So that's it for Cape Codders. Also on the MEMA website, which is another thing that people, you can go on online under MEMA and go under Radiological Emergency Planning. They have the plan, and this is in their plan book. This is the plume exposure. So right now we're told you're not going to leave the Cape, you're going to shelter in place. So we said, well, what does that mean? What does that mean? Because a radiological emergency is very different than a regular emergency. If you're outside, it's 100% hit. If you're in your car, there's no protection. In your house, with no basement, 10% protection. In the basement of your home, 40% protection. So you're still gonna take the hit. Also too, you know we have potassium iodide available in all the towns on the Cape, all right? So this is another thing. This is, it's a salt that will flood your thyroid so that you won't intake radioactive iodine, which causes thyroid cancer. This is available to everyone on Cape Cod. But it only protects against the radioactive iodine. It doesn't protect against the cesium or the strontium. And cesium is huge in an event because that's what's in the waste pool. But again, too, if you look at this, what is this? It's a pill provided by a corporation to the public, a medication. So if they mess up, this is what you get.
It's only taking care of the thyroid.
Right.
I mean, there's other cancers.
But what other?
If you want to ask questions, not you. I mean, it's better than just people talking.
Okay. Yeah. Any questions on it?
No, the county does have the distribution for that.
Yes.
You know, for that pill.
Yes. But yes. And actually, it's in some school systems too. Yes. But I think the bottom line is this is a corporate pill. What other corporation gives people the public medication?
Right.
If you want to pursue that, there's a responsibility that this corporation has to do a lot of things, and I think this is just one of the responsibilities they have to bear the cost of this, because they're the beneficial owners of the plant, and they do have some responsibility for providing a level of protection. I think that what we're trying to figure out is how far does that extend? Isn't that your intention?
Yeah, and they do pay for this. Yeah, they're assessed the cost.
This is something that Matt Patrick fought for when he was sitting
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
He worked and worked year after year until
mm-hmm.
he finally got
mm-hmm.
this in place.
Right, yeah. Right. The interesting part is that it is on the Cape, but it's not in the other part of the 50-mile EPZ. Boston doesn't have it. People in Pembroke don't have it, but we have it.
Well, the other thing is, say this happens, say it happens this afternoon, God forbid. And not only do people not have it on them, now they gotta go out of their home to an exposed area, to a place that is now exposed because it's letting all this public in, to go and get this, which is also another glut of panic within small communities. So, I mean, if they're gonna provide it, I mean, how are they getting it to you and where's the explanation? You're gonna get it mailed, like, you know, like a nickel on your, an advertisement.
It's very difficult. You know, the emergency planners have tried through the years to try to get it into people, but people are complacent. And there's not been enough education or enough talk about being, at least this, potassium iodide pill, you know, that's all that we're asking.
Right, if I might through the chair.
Sure.
I think, you know, getting into KI, first of all, Bill's right. As the county health department, we've worked with the 15 communities to make sure that there's been some sort of plan to distribute and work on the excellent work that Representative Patrick did during that time, which was to get that out. And I think we have it on the Cape and the islands as well. And we've received it once, we've actually gone through and we've received it a second time because the first set of pills have expired. So another group were brought in. We've also developed some educational pamphlets for that. And working with the school systems is to, and it has not happened in every school system yet, but working with the school systems and trying to have it there. Sheila, you bring up an excellent point. What happens is a lot of times when people remember this, it's after something has already occurred. And I think Plymouth is a great example. They, even within the EPZ, I think they only have about a 20% rate of the population actually going to get potassium iodide. And they've seen that in EPZs in quite a few places. And this is, you know, now this is as Diane said, this helps you with one thing. And it's really important that the children get it. It's really an important part of that. So that, hence why it's so important to have it ready for the school systems. But also remember with the school systems, to give an aspirin in a school,
exactly.
you need the governor, not only kidding, but you need quite a bit of approvals before that happens. And so we're, you know, that's one of the things that we have to go through. We have to have permission slips received. And there may even, you know, be issues where one child gets it, one child doesn't, because it all comes down to permission slip. But those are projects that, you know, our health agents are doing a really, really good job on. And it's important. It's very important. But I think what's also important is, and if we can use this few minutes for advertisement, talk to your Board of Health. Right. And if you want to get these pills, get them.
Right.
Yep, because they're there.
Right. And if I can just reiterate too, infants and children are the most susceptible to the damaging effects of ionizing radiation.
Pregnant women.
Right. So again, too, this is just kind of exposes the risk that we're at, that we have to have this medication for our population. Okay. All right, now. Director Kurt Schwartz, I don't know if you were at the meeting, but Director Kurt Schwartz spoke in October for the Barnstable County Regional Emergency Planning Committee. It was great that the county set this whole program up. But he came down and we had asked, what are the plans for Cape Codders? And with chilling honesty, he gave us the plan. This is like a 3-minute just audio clip, but he talks about inhalation as the immediate threat in the 10-mile EPZ. He talks about ingestion of eating something, okay, even though it's in the air.
All right. Short and long term.
Yes. All right, and these are quotes that you're gonna hear him say, okay? I don't know if this is on, is this on, this is
it
on
should,
audio,
yeah.
Okay. All right.
Now, okay. People that are in this area are at risk of ingestion danger, which is a long time, this comes from a long time exposure. It does not come from having been in there for an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours a day. It comes from
Okay, let me try that.
before our incident.
All right, I'm just going to go back. Sorry that the audio isn't working. I'll hold it up so you can hear
it. It was chilling when we were all sitting there listening to this.
Okay. It seems like it's coming up on this screen, but not on my laptop. Okay. Let me see if we do this. All right, we'll try it again, and I'll just, I guess I'll hold up my... Okay.
Now.
Yeah. We'll do it, right?
People that are in this area are at risk of ingestion danger, which is a long time...
Oh, that's me. I did, sorry.
Sorry.
All right, let me try that again. I'm trying to work off this computer too, I don't know how to... All right, one more time, all right? Third time's a charm, right? Is that what you say?
That's what they say.
Okay. All right.
Now, people that are in this area are at risk of ingestion danger, which is a long time, Now, this comes from a long time exposure. It does not come from having been in there for an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours a day. It comes from, but there is a very significant and deadly risk from long term ingestion of radioactive materials. So, if this were our incident, what would we have done as the state? In the immediate hours, we would have worked to evacuate people that were within 10 miles to minimize the inhalation risk. Over the next number of days, we would have mapped this area, and once we had identified this area, we would then issue a relocation order and order anyone within this area to leave the area. And we would enforce that. This is not an evacuation. An evacuation is an emergency, quick, get out of town order, which says, get in your car and get the hell out of town because there's an imminent danger. This is not an evacuation. This is a relocation. It is not urgent. We have the time to plan it, and what we did in this drill and what we would do in real life is identify all of the roads and the major roads. We work with local and state police and the Department of Transportation. We would seal off all of the roads in and out. We would send people into these areas with protective clothing and help everybody relocate out. We would move animals, anything living, we would move out. And the unfortunate reality, which is what Fukushima faces today, is that this area may well be closed to anyone for years to come.
And in spite of expressing that concern in a public meeting, I see no evidence where MEMER had actually, let's say, move forward with any substantial evidence of planning that put pressure on the company. Several years before we got to this point, I had approached Senator Wolf and written him a note on this, and also asked for a meeting with the energy people, mm-hmm. and said I would be available immediately to go over there because Sheila had as our representative of the National Seashore had brought that up, and I felt that some action needed to be taken. Mm-hmm. The result of that was they'd get back to me. And at that point, I think that Senator Wolf had started the momentum that he developed. So there was, you're looking at a board of commissioners that has not ignored this issue.
Right. We understand that.
No, we understand. Right. Right. It's just you feel very frustrated, like everyone else does.
Well, again, too, we'd like you to join the voice and mm-hmm. make a public statement that he's telling us, like at Fukushima, we might never come home. We are an identified population at risk. It's a corporation that's boiling water to make electricity. This isn't like a public service that needs to be in place. And we know it was relicensed over the objections of a lot of elected officials. It also wasn't designed to run over 40 years. And I already went through that whole list of concerns about the urgency of the matter for public health and safety. Yeah.
Go ahead. I'm sorry. I was going to say early this morning there was a wastewater meeting, or the Water Protection Collaborative met, and Tom Marie Rogers from Webner was here. And so I listened to probably the last 15 minutes of her presentation. And in the very end, she talked about risks, and she talked about climate change. But you can apply the same factors here. The risks equal to what is your vulnerability. And so when you look at this situation here with the plant, we know what the risks are, but then how vulnerable are we to those risks? And we're entirely vulnerable because we can't go anywhere. So I mean, there aren't any options to speak of.
Right.
There is the potassium iodide, but that's not a solution.
Right.
So I think when we talk about risk assessment, and that's what I think we as commissioners are looking at as you present this to us in terms of Cape Cod, what is the risk and how vulnerable are we? And what are our options? And our options are nearly zero.
Right. So, and that brings us back to our question, can public safety be assured?
Exactly.
The Nuclear Regulatory Federal mandate of oversight states that they can shut down any reactor if the public safety cannot be assured. And that's why we're saying, okay, they're not doing it because the NRC tends to support the industry and their way of business. That's why we need public officials and the public to stand up for our own public safety. So just to let you know, so okay, we're talking about assurance of public safety. Even our own Senator Markey said, the Nuclear Regulatory Commission has abdicated its responsibility to ensure public health and safety in New England and across the country. Because one of the lessons learned from Fukushima was that they needed to put filters on the vents, and the NRC commissioners voted against it. Only Allison McFarland, the chair, voted for the vents because, as she said, she had seen the devastation in Japan. So here's our senator saying they've abdicated their responsibility. So here it is. The Nuclear Regulatory Commission protecting people and the environment. We need to hold them to this mandate here, and this is it. This is a direct quote. They have the authority to take action, including shutting down any reactor.
I have one question.
I thought we were going to wait till the end.
There's one more slide. I think it's just your... Okay, so this is what we're asking of the commissioners. We've presented, you know, that you've seen Director Schertz say we're in harm's way, that we're not going to evacuate. We find this is unacceptable and in violation of the public trust. All 15 towns have voted to ask the governor to call on the Nuclear Regulatory Commission to close Pilgrim. The governor has even acknowledged there's no viable evacuation in such circumstances and shares our concerns. The Association for the Preservation just came out with a whole study and called for all the permits to be terminated and Pilgrim to be decommissioned. And even our Senator Markey says they've abdicated their responsibility. So we're asking the county commissioners to call on the Nuclear Regulatory Commission to uphold their federal mandate oversight mandate and immediately order the revocation of the operating license of Pilgrim Nuclear Power Station because the health and safety of the residents and visitors of Cape Cod cannot be assured.
So let's just talk about the petition, you know, and what it is we want to do rather than talk about the whole issue. I think, you know, because we could talk about it for a long time. But our purpose here today is to decide or discuss this petition and if this is what we are willing to sign, if we want to read it over and make any changes to it, and
if
we're satisfied
petition,
with the way it's
well,
written.
Go
ahead, Bill.
I believe that one of the prime responsibility that you brought up in your discussion is the responsibility for guaranteeing public safety. One of the issues that I've not been happy with when, you know, in terms of the public response or lack of response from a corporation that, you know, that owns it, is that they have not acknowledged the responsibility that comes from the beneficial owner of a profit-making activity that says that while they are responsible for the reliability of its operation in terms of generating electricity, they take no responsibility with regard to the safety of the, presenting a plan that presents viable evacuation, viable protection. I've always been concerned about the, from the beginning, that we have to drive towards the event if one happened from here. And there are a lot of people in the upper part of the Cape that don't work in the Cape. They work in Boston and so forth. And I saw no evidence of support for that. However, the fact that the Nuclear Regulatory Agency has upheld the statute with regard to the licensing says that perhaps the petition that we pursue is one that's within the reasonable ability of the corporation to actually do, which I say is they ought to have an ability to take, let's say if we're going to evacuate, how would they do that?
Right.
Now, I think that we ought to hear from our own emergency planning committee, because I believe that they've been working on some of this as well.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And before you do that, I have a very strong feeling about this, because I think it's unacceptable to say you're stuck there. You're in harm's way, so you can't leave, you can't, you're there. So, I just find that, in times of national security, our national security being threatened, for instance, the one that we can all remember is 9/11. Immediately, there was a federal plan in place where airports shut down, military planes were employed. There was a whole thing there was a plan that went into action. It might have been written 10 years ago, but everybody knew the plan and everybody knew what to do as far as the federal government and its response. I think that can they guarantee that this will all work, according to the textbook? No, but there has to be a plan where they have coordinated ferries, regional airplanes, the base. There are ways to get people off this berg, and it's going to be costly, and it's going to cost a lot to coordinate it and to make sure everybody has their part. But if they're not going to do this, they have to at least guarantee that, and that it goes into effect, and it has to have the backing of the federal government with it. Or the federal government has to understand that that's too big of an undertaking, and they have to close it down. And I think that that's something along those lines that we should be demanding. And since they are not listening to closing it, you've got to guarantee us we're out of here, and you're going to pay for us getting out of here.
There's another issue. There have been several nuclear plants that have been closed. Main Yankee, Wiscasset, Roe. In those cases, did they remove the spent fuel from the site?
Yes, they did.
Roe did.
Yeah.
Okay. So I don't know about Maine.
Wiscasset didn't.
I think Vermont Yankee has not started. No, I'm sorry, not Vermont. You're talking about Roe.
Main Yankee, and the one in Vermont.
Vermont is still operating until the end of the year.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, okay, so it has not started.
Right, and okay. There, yeah.
And then part of this, in terms of, as a practical matter, that generates and has some of the responsibility of generating electricity to support the needs for energy in the southeastern part of Massachusetts. The other plants that are operating, Canal is only operating, I think, like a couple of days a month now. And that's also generating, as a fossil fuel, that's also generating a certain amount of pollution. Going up to Boston, with New Boston and some of the other plants, to Mystic and some of the others, would that mean that those plants which are producing, air pollutants and particulate matter, would those have to operate longer or at a higher level in order to make up for the loss of the electrical operation of
Yeah, well, when we talk about Pilgrim, this is a public safety issue, not an energy issue. It's a serious, urgent public safety issue. When we're hearing people tell us, the doctor about the cancers and no assurance of public safety within that 10-mile EPZ, we hear Dr. Gordon Thompson saying the spent fuel pool is an imminent danger. We're looking at a public safety issue, not an energy issue. According to the ISO, the independent system operators that run the grid, Pilgrim produces 5% of the energy mix for Massachusetts for the whole grid. So there are other energy sources that could be used instead of Pilgrim. And in fact, Pilgrim should not have been relicensed, so they should be prepared to close down Pilgrim. It shouldn't have been relicensed for 20 more years. So we really want to keep it focused on that public safety issue, because that's what is the real matter right now. But again, the energy, it's 5% of the energy mix into the...
Well, if we kept working on our renewables.
Renewables.
Yeah. Great, yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Well, we work quite a bit. As was mentioned, we sponsored the meeting with Kurt Schwartz back in 2012. And one of the things that came out of that meeting was actually a Pilgrim task group. And so a lot of us in the room here, we work together on doing some public education and planning and things of that sort. One of the issues is we are not within the EPZ. We are in the IPZ, the ingestion pathway zone. So we don't see the funding, the planning money that's available to communities that are within the EPZ. So we're working on things with, as best we can. And I mean, you look at towns like Bourne, you look at towns like Sandwich, they're really trying to do a good job trying to get information out to their communities. And then you look at the efforts of the boards of health trying to get information out to information and potassium iodide out to everybody. But Sheila, you bring up a really good point. We are a funnel. We have two bridges. Mm-hmm. And so we can't even really evacuate for a hurricane in many ways.
We kind of, on a Sunday evening in the summertime, there's no evacuation.
So we're very limited as to where you go. And when you look at the whole Pilgrim concern, you also look at, okay, if the EPZ is evacuating, how are they leaving the town of Plymouth? Well, they're not just going north. They're going south, they're going west. So there's bound to be some crossover. So we've been working on some education materials and trying to talk to people about sheltering in place. And we've had some really good meetings. We've brought our public information officer in, Kevin Morley, who's assisting us with developing some things. MEMA has gotten a little bit more involved with it since this meeting at this point. Many of you heard back in, I think the Cape Cod Times had an article about it a few months ago, about a phone survey that was done. And that was actually, one of the things, and you and I had talked about it quite frequently, Sheila, was this, do we know how many people would try to leave the Cape should there be an emergency? And at Pilgrim, and we saw in this phone survey, we saw that potentially 50% of the population would try to leave. That actually gave us finally that benchmark that we really needed to know. Because, you think about it, what's our population year round?
216.
216, mm-hmm. So we have 108,000 people, at least by a phone survey of about, 500 folks, 1,000 folks, whatever the number was. That could potentially leave. But also then think about it, how high does our population go up to in the summer months?
Exactly.
And so it really makes for difficult planning procedures and emergency planning procedures. Now, the other thing that should be coming out soon, and it's in a draft state, is MEMA and Entergy, and also with the consulting company that Entergy uses, they actually have started to look at the Cape and look at estimated times of evacuation. So hopefully that information is going to be available to us pretty soon. And that is, okay, how long would it take to get people over that bridge? And how long would it take if you're moving everybody from Plymouth out of the EPZ? And so these are things that are taking place right now. We saw as a need, and I think what a lot of the emergency managers have seen as a need, is this whole education point. It's how do we talk to our citizens as to what's going on here? How do we get this information out? But it's not only talking to our citizens, it's also talking to our guests and our visitors that come in. And because we are, our population pretty much triples now during the summer months. We're 750, 800,000 people, I think, somewhere in that market. And that's where we've had a really good, and we've had some really good discussions and everything as to how we're gonna put together some things regarding potassium iodide, regarding sheltering in space, in place, excuse me, but also discussing the traffic issues as well. Because if folks decide to go if there's word of an emergency at Plymouth and everybody decides they're gonna go towards the bridge at once, they're not gonna go anywhere. And that whole funnel effect is gonna happen again. So we wanna get that word out. And please correct me if I'm missing anything, Bill, or, you know, but we're adding that in.
I just wanna say that, you know, we've had these meetings where we're supposed to meet with MEMA and they have been pushing us off for months.
Yes.
So in reality, it's wait, just as Mr. Dougherty said.
It's right, except we're starting to take the lead on that. Now, luckily, Senator Wolf and I wanna make sure that the senator gets the kudos on this, because he has reached out to Kurt Schwartz, the director of MEMA, and actually Seth Rollbein participates with this education committee as well, as does Senator Representative Keating's office. We have Anthony Morris that attends our meetings now as well, and Senator Wolf met with Director Schwartz, and you know, we're starting to get assurances that we will start seeing MEMA people. But that's been one of the issues, is there's been kind of this, well, let's wait and see what the phone survey says. Well, let's wait and see what this ETE says, and then try to develop. Well, and but for us, it finally got to that point where it's like, we gotta act on our own here. And that's when we began to use our public information officer to start to establish, and we'll be happy to come in and make a presentation to you at a future time of some of the work that we're doing. But Senator Wolf, what the senator was able to do was really good. Now, we're expecting, and I did see somebody from MEMA yesterday. I was actually at MEMA at the headquarters. I think they're going to try to attempt to make our next meeting as a part of it. I think they're a little concentrated right now on the Boston Marathon and what's happening there, and okay, understand that. You know, we'll if we can get them a little bit more involved, we'll be good. But Janet's absolutely right. You know, it's been tough to try to bring them to the table. And you also have to look at this too in different ways, where we're a pretty big region. So what we may need to put in information for the town of Bourne may be different for the town of Harwich or for the town of Wellfleet. Mm-hmm. And these are things that we're working on and working on as well. So we have a couple of emergency managers that participate with that committee. One of our co-chairs, Mark Foley, participates. We also have Chief Kyle Tocasian from Truro that works with this group as well. So we've got a good representation from the REPC there.
Well, my reaction to all this is really important to have this conversation and to have this planning going on. It's critical because we are in this position right now where we are. But yeah. Wouldn't it have been better in hindsight to have had it before the plant was ever built? In other words, if you're going to put a plant there, these are the things you have to do. But now that it's here, it's an aging plant. Mm-hmm. And it's also suffered more shutdowns than many other plants. So it's really at an end point. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't preclude the fact that we have to continue to plan for this, because anything could happen, and who knows how long it might take. But I really do honestly believe that we have to address most of our efforts to getting the plant closed.
Right.
I mean, that's where it should go. It's not that far off anyway, where it has to be closed. Do it now, and let's not waste any more time.
And if I just might add, I mean, our concern is, even if there's storage up there, we still have a concern.
That's right.
You know, yes, so we're always,
right.
You know.
We'll always have that concern.
I think that's
and that's
the contingency with regard to closing that does not involve the removal of spent fuel is one that I think has to be thought through. That's why I think that my wish would be that there'd be a viable evacuation plan that the company is responsible for. That to me is something that is absolutely essential. Moving to or making a statement that we think the plant should be closed, I don't think would actually get anything accomplished other than we'd just be ignored because of the relicensing.
Well, I'm not saying just do that, but that's the goal, is to have it closed. Now, this webinar, isn't there a new system now where these fuel spent rods can be placed in some kind of that protect it so that
there is a dry cask storage.
A dry cask, yeah.
Yep. We are doing we do have NRC doing a webinar for our public officials, for our police chiefs, our fire chiefs, our public safety folks. And if folks are interested, they can email me and I will get them registered. We have a couple of locations where it's going to happen. We have it set up where it will be at the Harwich Community Center and it will also be at the Bourne Community Center. People for those should sign up with me, but they can also watch it on their computer in their office if they would like, and that would be I think I forwarded to you the flyer on it for April 24th.
I mean, from what we really hear, the plant isn't safe. I mean, if you start rating it on 1 to 10, it's not the safest plant. So we should be working to probably not make it safe because it's too old in a certain sense. So
right.
Can it even function beyond 5 years or 7 years or whatever?
They're spending
and there's going to have to be a time when that issue of the spent fuel rods is going to have to be taken up anyway.
I was working for Boston Edison when they came up with the plan, and that was viewed as we won't have to meter electricity anymore because electricity would be so cheap. That was that was the dream back in the 60s, and I'm that old. At the same time, life extension with at utility companies, and I was a product manager and I've been at utility companies all over the world, and focusing on this, the concern that I have is that I want to sign a document that I think has an affect rather than just stating a position. And the affect to me is that if we were to sign something that says they should close, it should be or give tangible evidence that a plan is being put in place that guarantees the public safety, because so all of the threat of this conversation, that is the primary issue. And now, do I believe that tomorrow, there will be an accident up there? Well, I can't predict the future, but in terms of a personal risk assessment, and just for that superficial information that comes from having worked in that industry, over time, I don't think that plant is immediately at risk. We haven't even mentioned that. What did they do when they repaired the crack in the reactor vessel about 15 years ago? Did anybody talk about that? Okay, that's another issue.
But we have to really weigh the risks, We don't know. And we know what happened in Fukushima. We know this is an aging plant. We know that it has a very poor operating level. It has issues with it. We know we need to work on an evacuation plan because it takes time for the other to happen. So we have to work on all these at the same time. So I guess the question is, if it isn't this document we want to sign, then let us take a look at preparing something very similar to it, including it in some of the concerns, and we'll put it back on our next agenda.
Right. I would like to put
go ahead.
These are things that we want.
That maybe there are things that we want to say that are not
a little bit stronger than what
the emphasis in my mind would be to say that we are taking a stand that says that we are very concerned that this profit-making operation, even though it's in Chapter 11 or whatever it is, has a responsibility to provide to the public some evidence that they are showing a real concern for public safety by putting a reasonable and tangible plan in place that shows how they're going to take care of it, and not put it on the taxpayers that, okay, if something goes wrong, you're on your own and call it the National Guard.
Right.
I can foresee the NRC saying, we have those things in place. We have done everything that's made this plant safe just as we've made every other plant safe. So I agree with everything that you said, but I think a statement like this would be very powerful.
Right,
and then we can work on another statement.
But it also, we should say that we recognize that there are those plans in place, and they're not adequate because they are reflecting what they think roads look like. Let them come here and see that we have very narrow roads. It's not like we have a superhighway that leads out of here and superhighways that connect into it and alternate roads. There's one way in and one way out, pretty much. And so I think that we should be much more forceful in saying it's not, what you're proposing isn't sufficient, and we have to think of the people that live here.
That there's not anything that I could not agree with.
No, me neither.
Here. Maybe we need to write a letter that accompanies the petition.
That would be,
that adds a few more comments of ours rather than trying to change the petition.
Right.
The petition is what it is, and it's very powerful. Sean?
I think what's important here is to remember, what's happening is we are not part of a good portion of the planning. Okay, we're outside of the EPZ. It's the EPZ that gets the funding. Town of Plymouth does their planning. They receive the funding as part of NRC requirements and Entergy, I know they do some work with KLD, the engineering company, and everything else. So, we are trying to do, and we're going to continue to do what we can, and we've had some preliminary work done. We're having an estimated time of evacuation done. We've had a phone survey done. We're starting to get a little bit of work, and we're going to continue on the best we can. But remember that the focus for this is that EPZ, and I think if you listen to Director Schwartz, that is where they are focusing their efforts, is the EPZ portion.
Right. Okay, well, again,
and would you just say what that means again so everybody knows?
It's the emergency planning zone.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And there is a power in signing a petition. There is a modification in signing a letter that explains the position. My feeling is that the petition that we sign reflect all of the things that we've talked about. When you say that you have no problem with signing a petition, I don't think it goes far enough.
I agree.
Okay. Oh, you don't think it goes far enough?
No, right, I agree.
Exactly. And that's the point that I've been making.
Is this a sort of like Boston?
In the sense that it does not address the responsibility that both the corporation has and the state has to respond to this.
Our needs.
Right. Okay. This is like an off-Cape letter. Right. But we're specific. We're saying you haven't looked here. We are more vulnerable for all of these other reasons.
Yeah.
And we demand some.
And again, getting back to the thrust and the importance to all of us, which is our personal safety and the isolation that we would face because we would be driving towards the event. I believe that all of the people that we've talked, corporations aren't really people, I guess, but all the, all of the things that we talked about, the federal government, the state government, and the private sector, in the case of this corporation, needs to be put on notice that they are not, that if, irrespective of the fact that they got their life extension approved, irrespective of the fact that their licensing was extended, they have ignored the legitimate concerns that we've had. Even when I read the governor's letter, there's not enough strength in that letter, especially since he's a pal of Obama. I might have suggested that you tell DeVal to call up Brack and say, get on it. Yeah. I would also have suggested that Governor Patrick talk to his own DPU and say, you are part of the executive branch and you have some responsibility of telling me that this plant is safe or not. We have a Department of Public Utilities. precisely to guarantee, you know, that the service is reliable and all the rest of it. I haven't seen any evidence of that. And that's the thing that I brought up to Senator Wolf, and that's the thing that I had brought in the correspondence and the conversation I've had about it. So having said that, I don't think this goes far enough. I want to have these other things included in it. So the petition has the strongest intent possible with regard to the public safety piece. And if, when it does that, I'd have no problem.
So you want to add more content to the therefore.
Right.
Therefore.
Yeah.
Do you want to give it a try?
Well,
and send it out to us.
We have someone who actually comes from a place that has a large nuclear power plant.
Oh, okay.
Our administrator.
Right.
And I was going to task him with having heard all of these things to formulate a piece, a continuation to the therefore, that truly emphasizes. You know, the fact that we're looking for these other agencies to take some responsibility for, you know, say, exactly. for taking
yeah.
their part
yeah.
of
the You're right.
You know,
yeah, it's not just the governor. I agree. Hold them to task, too, because then their job is to, as you say, is inform. So you've got to go, that might be the next, you know.
You know, the state agencies have a hands-off policy when it comes to entity.
Then you got to show them the gun.
You know, MEMA just rubber stamps the plants, the compound safety plants. They don't have to approve these. They can disapprove them, you know.
That's my point.
Right.
The guy running the nuclear preparedness department at MEMA comes from the industry.
We're aware that they are not being responsible.
And you can see that, but you don't want somebody that's wet into it. You know, I mean, you can see it's going to have the expertise. The other thing that you, another pool of data that you could always go to, and it's not as, you know, we have the Fukushima, so it's immediate, but we haven't now seen 10 years up of Fukushima. So what is, and now they're letting some people back into some of the further area.
5 hours a day, 10 times
a day. Oh, is it only five hours? Oh, so they're not moving right back in.
But one of the things that they did in Japan is change the acceptable level of radiation to the population. They raised it up.
Right.
So now they changed the rates.
Right. But you have Chernobyl, and Chernobyl, you know, I remember reading 12 years afterwards, it was called The Silent Killer, and it was this beautiful picture of, you know, some mountaintop with these, you know, deer or reindeer, you know, grazing in this pasture, and it's like, you know, they're doomed because they're eating this grass. You know, they are, their offspring are going to, you know, succumb to stomach cancer. And I had a neighbor who, many years after Chernobyl, he worked in Germany a lot, and they were issued Geiger counters at the open air markets with all the, so that they could test the level of radioactivity in the food that was being sold, and they could pick the right vegetables so they, with the lowest amounts. In the stomach cancers across the region were huge and still remain to be. So there are so many long-term unintended consequences that nobody pays attention to. They look at the immediate disaster. That's not going to happen here. That's not going to be as bad here. It's a different thing. This wasn't, you know, a tsunami that did it. It was an accident that let go a lot of dangerous, toxic materials.
Okay, so can we sort of wrap up?
Yep.
Okay. Well, I'd like to make a motion that we add a stronger statement.
That we adopt the petition
as presented with a stronger statement, which we will task our executive to to draft, and that at our next meeting we will review it and sign it.
Right. And I second that.
All right. Any discussion on the motion? Well, it's a little late, but you can tell us later. Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Unanimous.
All right.
This was something, it's different, but it's not. It's very connected. The NRC is now talking to the nuclear energy people, and tomorrow is the end of a comment period that we can make as individuals, as residents, as citizens, as commissioners, to say that what they want to do is exempt the nuclear energy providers from any kind of support of the emergency planning after decommissioning.
1 year after decommissioning.
And we can't do that. We're going to have that nuclear waste dump there, whether they close it tomorrow. But we can do that. I've got, you know, I wrote something. I have some information that I can show you.
Because Safe Harbors would be paid to, you know, to, let's say, to get rid of the nuclear waste. I mean, they're up in Hingham, aren't they?
Yeah, they're on the South Shore someplace.
Clean Harbors.
Clean Harbors, thank you.
Yeah, yeah.
No, they were shipping the low-level waste, radioactive waste down to someplace in North Carolina, but they closed. Now, South Carolina, now they're storing the low-level waste there as well. The other wrinkle to this whole decommissioning thing is that the NRC allows the reactor owners to leave all the spent fuel in the pool for 60 years after decommissioning.
Well, it was, you know, this is very ironic because initially they were supposed to only have temporary storage on site.
That was the original. Congress could never make a decision.
Well, it's always changing the regulations to suit what the industry was asking. We need more space. Okay, we'll make them tighter. Well, you know, we need to store them there. We can't afford these dry casks at how much a shot? $1 million. It's to me, it's criminal, and you know, this is something that each of us can do. I didn't make enough copies for everyone, but there's, you know, a place where you can go to. It doesn't have to be a long comment. I don't know if you've heard of the Pilgrim Watch. Mary Lampert prepared a long statement, but I prepared one. My husband said it was a little too emotional, but I wrote it as a citizen, as a parent, a grandparent, and someone who's aware that there are, you know, more pool fires, or pool fires in these spent fuel pools are so dangerous and such a risk. And we're, you know, we've been named by the Pentagon, Pilgrim has been, as one of the at risk for aircraft attack, you know, from the water.
Right.
And we are on, I think we're second, I keep saying we, but we are. Pilgrim is on, named as the second most at risk for earthquake. And that, you know, that's a small chance, but I remember hearing a scientist at Woods Hole, a respected senior advisor, and he said, you don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, so you have to expect the worst. So this whole thing about the emergency planning is despicable.
Exactly.
And so this is something that, you know, as individuals we might be able to do.
Thank you. That's, you know, it's unacceptable. And what they're trying to do now is just pass off the, I guess that's for all of us, pass off
the other, I didn't make copies.
Okay. So pass off the responsibility, you know, from themselves to, and then we get to pay for it, right?
Well, we want to thank you very much for coming.
Yes, and thank you for all of your work.
You did a great job in explaining this whole issue.
Really.
And how important it is for all of us to respond and to act. So I thank you very much.
I just want to thank Sean. Sean, the Emergency Management Director, has been great.
We thank him every day.
Yeah.
Very lucky, actually.
If we don't, we should.
Thank you.
Great.
Thank you.
All right, thanks.
Well, thank you. Okay.
We have to continue with our meeting.
Chris, is this for me to keep now?
Let's just
take a quick recess. Okay, we're back from recess, and we want to take up the remaining matters of business, which are the minutes of April 1st.
I will move to accept the minutes of April 1st.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Unanimous. And the list of the summary of items?
I have not seen anything I can object to. I'd like to make a motion to approve.
Okay.
I don't have no questions, and
motion to approve?
I made the motion.
Oh, you did?
Second.
All right, any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. None opposed, motion carries. Is there any other report? Michael, do you have any report you'd like to make?
Just a couple. Very briefly, the town of Barnstable Town Council President sent us a letter talking about their 375th rededication of the town seal. And they've created a sculpture that's, I believe it's 12 feet high by 10 feet long. And they would like to have this placed in front of the James Otis and the Mary Otis Warren statues. during the last week of April in place for their May 4th rededication of the town seal event. And so their staff would be putting it in place and tying it into our electrical. And they simply want permission to be able to put it on county property.
It's interesting. I saw that email. Mm-hmm. And then I looked at it and I said, they want to put this in between and it's three numbers. And I'm trying to think, what could those three numbers possibly be about? Now I get it. So a motion to approve?
Yes, I'll make the motion.
Second.
Okay, any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? None opposed? Motion carries.
One final issue, commissioners. The town of Barnstable received a grant recently from the Massachusetts Coastal Zone Management Community Resilience Grant Program in the amount of $52,500. And the effort is for the town of Barnstable to create a community rating system program for the town specific. And they've been talking with our cooperative extension staff about letting some of the county staff that's got a little bit of expertise in that area to draft, along with the town, a particular program that not only could be used by the town of Barnstable, but the other 14 communities on the Cape. Per discussion, there's some thinking about possibly allowing the county to take on this grant and have our staff create the particular template program that could be used. And so there's a request to have our community extension staff, cooperative extension staff, come back at the next meeting and kind of give them an overview of what they were recommending, how to use the grant and what to do with the program.
And again, what is the purpose of the grant?
It would be creating a template community rating system program for the Cape that all of the towns could use, and creating a resilience for flood management practice that could be used as far as lowering FEMA insurance rates.
Oh, I see. So a rating for risk?
Risk assessment.
Risk,
yes.
Assessment. Oh, I think that's great. Very good. Yeah. In fact, that
ties in with what we're
it
talking
ties
about.
In with everything that we're talking about.
That sounds great.
I think it would be good to do it, to have the county do it.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea.
So this would go through the cooperative extension?
It would. And so I would like to have the cooperative extension staff come back at the next meeting. And
yes, I would like to hear a little bit more detail about what it is they would be doing and how they'd be doing it.
It would be very difficult for one town to do, surely. Mm. So this would.
That's the thinking of the town of Barnstable.
Right.
Yeah, and it's a regional issue, so that's mm-hmm. great. That's mm-hmm. good. I'm good. Glad they're good. Thinking regionally like we are.
Absolutely.
Thinking money.
No, but it would be.
So, Bill, do you have anything you
want to
bring up?
Yeah, I went to the HAC annual meeting last week, and Sheila was there as well.
I was there. Pat was there, too.
We were all there, and it was a great crowd.
It was a very good crowd.
We ought to be very proud of the fact that here on Cape Cod, there are a lot of people that care, volunteer for the, you know, to help the homeless and to participate.
The room was full.
It was absolutely full, and it was a great time, and the recognition that was given to the people who were there, I think, is very important. The other thing that I wanted to mention was that, as you know, I represent you on the Town of Barnstable Human Needs Committee, mm-hmm. and we met on Monday, Tuesday night, and we heard from someone called, an organization called Learn to Cope, and the person was a volunteer, a father, with a child that had heroin addiction, and was pointing out that this support group, which I'd like to mention, meets in Yarmouth on Tuesday from 7 to 8:30 at the Yarmouth Police Station at 3340 Higgins Crawl Road, is a support group for families that have children that have problems with drug addiction. You know, one of the points that he pointed out, there's a path that that goes from pharmaceuticals that are found in the house to, let's say, to getting to, you know, drugs that are available on the street, and points out that there are, that heroin is super cheap right now. Now, this is an issue not just on Cape Cod, not just in Boston, but reading the New England papers over the last, you know, last couple of weeks, it has been a topic that's, you know, that's in New Hampshire, that's in Maine, that's in Vermont, Connecticut. It's all over the place. So we can't afford to close our eyes to it anymore. But those families that are trying to cope, that, you know, that should know that they're not alone, and that on the Cape at least, if they go to the Yarmouth Police Station on Tuesdays at 7 o'clock, that there's a support group there, and they're welcoming. If they want more information, they can call 508-738-5148, or they could visit www.learn2cope.org. But in any case, people should know that when they're facing a problem as serious as this, and by the way, the problems with a physical addiction to narcotics is something that is appearing in our middle schools. In our middle schools, if you think about that, it's you know, sixth grade, it's terrible. But in any case, families that are coping with it should know that there is some help in that support group, and I wanted to make sure that I brought that up. Again, the phone number to call for more information is 508-738-5148.
Okay. I wanted to mention a couple things. The Cape Cod Selectmen's Association decided that they wanted to honor the work of Senate President Murray and Cleo Turner, because both of them are not running for re-election. And so they there's going to be a breakfast on June 13th at the Daniel Webster Inn in Sandwich at 7:30 a.m. And I don't know about Cleo, but I know that Senator Murray has acknowledged that she will attend. And the other thing I wanted to mention from your meeting this morning, the second annual Cape Coastal Conference, we had one last year at the DoubleTree, and they're having it again this year on June 5th at 6th, implementing strategies to improve water quality and build coastal resilience. That ties in with this grant money that the town of Barnstable just got. So, I mean, the work that they're doing here, so.
And resiliency is
a
national
program.
Is
a new word now, right? Everybody's talking about resiliency. And then I wanted to mention also that all three of us attended the Barnstable Town Council meeting last week.
Oh yes.
Regarding the petition to eliminate the Cape Cod Commission or withdraw from the Cape Cod Commission, and the Town Council's attorney Ruth Weil actually had time in the two-week interim when they could not take it up 2 weeks ago to last week, had time to really review it and seek further counsel from the Secretary of State and the Attorney General's office. And it turned out that the petition as written was technically flawed and that it could not go forward in its present state. That it couldn't go anywhere because, and so also they pointed out that the petitioner was before the wrong government, that the towns never opted into the Cape Cod Commission, therefore all the legal opinions say towns cannot opt out on their own, that it was a countywide vote. So whatever government they're has to deal with it. We don't know yet whether it's
obviously they don't want to come to the government that they should.
Well,
because that way you would stop the conversation.
Right.
Well, I wanted to inquire. Does that really stop the petitions?
No, I mean, each town, it's on their warrant now, and each town is obligated to put it on the warrant.
So does it make sense?
No, they're not obligated to put it on.
They're not obligated. Harwich, for example, did not put it on the warrant.
If it's flawed, they don't have to put it on
the warrant. Yeah, because it's not a legal petition. He's not asking something that can be legally
done. We were going to show up at every, but I don't think it's a good thing to do if it's not going to be.
No, but that doesn't mean that some towns aren't going to go forward. I think some warrants are already written.
In the instance of Harwich, the purported sponsor, when contacted, because the Board of Selectmen in Harwich has the petitioner or the sponsor come forward to explain the petition, said, this is the first I heard of it. I just was the first one that signed it for, you know, for whoever was taking signatures at the mall, and said, I know nothing about being a sponsor. I did sign it, but I'm not the sponsor of it. And that was part of the reason why it was dismissed as being on, you know, as and of course, they had legal review as well.
Right.
So how would you dismiss it?
Yeah, see, you would have to, we'd have to check with each of the towns and see whether or not they agreed to put it on their market.
But I think the most important thing is that
we should
talk to the sponsor.
But they go to the AG and got it further, not just their own lawyer, okay?
Right.
Well, the town council did that. Now, every other town, some towns with their own council could look at it and realize that it was...
The reading she got came from the AG as well as her...
And the Secretary of State.
Right, and in their charter, the town council is responsible for responding to any hearing petition that the town of Barnstable has. And I think she made it quite clear in her presentation that she was acting in that role as well as being a conduit of information from the Attorney General.
Yeah, that's right. I just wanted to mention that. Thank you very much.
So...
Okay, so I did do quite a few things. So we have to back up. We did not have a meeting last week, correct? So what I did...
We had a meeting on April 1st. Yeah, we did. Well, we didn't have... We had a meeting, but there was...
We went to AmeriCorps.
We opened it and we adjourned it.
That's right. So we had our day at AmeriCorps. Pat and I were there. You were away. And it was really great. I had never been to Thompson's Field. I hate to say that.
Really?
But I do hate to say that.
Been there, yeah.
But I had not been there.
Have you been on the other part of Harwich?
On that other part of Harwich. And the work that the AmeriCorps people have done over the years with the DPW there and their conservation group and really sort of clearing that out, making it more open meadows. It's very beautiful, great place to walk. And we were totally impressed with the food pantry operation in Harwich. We had a long talk with the staff there, including Richard Waystack. And then we went to the community center, and what the what our purpose there was to plant a tree in honor of your Barbara.
You're supposed to say that.
Oh. But it didn't happen because you weren't there. So, oh, I'm sorry. I did not know. I thought that was on the agenda.
No.
Okay. Oh, I apologize. I let a cat out of the bag.
Reminded me then, since I wasn't at the
I think that was a meeting record doing that.
I did go to the reason I wasn't at the April 1st meeting. I was attending the Mass Municipal Association committee that I serve on.
Right.
And at that meeting, we had DHCD in, and we were discussing, you know, some of the concerns that we have about homelessness and what we're doing to respond to those issues. You know, at that level, so those are all things.
I feel really bad because I did let a surprise out and I did not realize that. I'm very sorry because it was on the agenda.
Well, we have a brick there, so that's...
Okay, great. so you never heard it?
No, I never heard it. Okay.
Okay, anyway, so that was a great day. And then I did go to the Community Development Partnership annual meeting. I have been asked to be on their advisory board, along with probably everybody else down the Outer Cape.
Never asked me.
So I know it's look like it was a pretty soft crowd from the Outer Cape. But anyway, one of the honorees was our own Jerry Rappaport, who has worked with the CDP for
19 years.
Wow. Years, along with Mary Lou Pettit and
Norm
Edensburg, also got an award. And the work that they have done with the businesses there is just really phenomenal. And I know that the CDP has worked with the workforce investment, but there is, I mean, and Jay is now on that board, but there's a lot of opportunities there, and they're doing great, great things.
They used to give us a report on their use of the license plate money because they're one of the recipients. But since Gwen had left, we haven't heard from them.
Well, we'll invite Jay in because it's worth everybody hearing what they're doing.
You
know, it is. It's very worth hearing. They're doing very good community work there that can be replicated in different areas. So I'm really impressed, and I'm very happy to be part of that officially.
Quite a good meeting.
It was a very good meeting. It was a great. It was very fun. Yeah, and it was short, sweet, to the point, and it was just great.
Did anybody go to the Eat Fresh, Eat Local?
Yes, and we, and Pat and I both went to that, so we made the rounds last week, we were together all the time, it seemed.
Could I just say that the award was not just for working with them, but for whatever I'd done in the community, which includes coming here anyway.
Yes, that's right, that's right. So then we had the Buy Fresh, Buy Local, which was at Cape Cod Beer, who could not have been more hospitable, as they always are with community events.
I like the blonde beer.
Yeah, I like the, but you know, they have a great port, porter.
Porter
beer. It's a seasonal, and you know, not everyone can make a porter good, because they can be too bitter. Guinness is, you know, you have to like it. This is an excellent taste, and I'm very fussy about porters, so they have a great porter beer for the season. I'm giving a little commercial for Cape Cod Beer.
The food was good.
All the food was provided by the growers and everything, so
it was just delicious. Pizza Barbone from Hyannis.
And all of their ingredients, and here's another you know, wave of the future, because these are practices that are being incorporated more and more. They grow all their vegetables on their rooftop. So the Pizza Barbone, so a lot of their ingredients were fresh from there, because they don't have enough garden space out in the back of their place. So and many places are beginning to adapt, you know, incorporate these things. And I know I did one other thing. I've been very, very busy, very busy. So I might as well tell you all about it. But what did I do yesterday? I think yesterday was. Oh, and this was the best one. So not the best, but equally as fun and interesting. The State Department does do these cultural exchange and information exchange programs, and they happen to sponsor all of the 9 directors or superintendents of the National Park Service of Russia. So they've been kind of going around the country looking at our national parks, and they ended up here. I didn't realize that they were kind of on their own. I thought they were affiliated strictly with the National Park. However, it's too bad we didn't grab them for one of their days here, because they had lots of questions about the county, the commission, the interaction, our support of the, you know, the local support, the county support, the state support of the National Seashore. And they also gave me a booklet, and I have email, so it would be interesting to stay in touch, and a couple of buttons that I brought for everybody here, and I forgot it this morning, so I'll bring it. But most of the national seashores are in that mountainous range, and some of them were taken when people lived there, so there was some of that, how do we live with our locals. Most of them now are B&Bs. And there was a timber industry that they had to curtail, so that was a big kerfuffle. But they were saying, well, you know, there are the nomads that go through the northern part of this park with their reindeer, you know, so it's very, still very rustic and rural, and huge vasts of land. But there was one woman who was a superintendent, and her park looks exactly like this place. I mean, when I show you this booklet, there are pictures that it makes, you would think that you were standing at the Marconi site at the National Seashore, looking out on both ends. It looks like the same exact view. Okay. And when George finally brought them to the beach, he said, finally, I said, oh, I'm bringing them all these places, I gotta bring them to the beach. He said, they were all jumping around like kids, they were all running around, they were throwing balls to each other, and he said, she was the only one that had a coastal park. So this was like a treat for them to be, they didn't care if it was, you know, 20 degrees. They just thought it was a beautiful seashore. They hadn't been to the seashore for a while. So it was really interesting, and they have very similar challenges. They don't have the backing of the federal government.
That's right, that's the
as we do.
Out, yeah.
And he said, for instance, like with Sochi, we just had like half our national top park taken away. Nobody could say anything about it to make Sochi. So, you know, when you have that type of government, you know, so for all of our complaints about how we do things, at least, and we sometimes feel that we don't have a say, we're in much better shape than even Russia today. I mean, you would have thought
learning.
That they had a little bit more, but they do. They are learning, and they are. And it's interesting, but in their own areas, democracy is happening because there is a lot of public exchange, and they have to build up these things. And they were like, "You are all friends here. How does that happen?" Because Wendy was there talking with the chamber, and like the number one draw for the Cape is the National Seashore. And, you know, so they were showing all their promotional materials and how they do this, and they like, so we were saying, well, I think we should go over there and, you know, have a real brainstorming, you know, session. So she's all for that. So if the Cape Chamber goes, I'm going. But so it was really very fascinating, and quite frankly, if we all could get rid of the politicians, we would all be working much better together, because citizens get it, and it's all, you know, it's all of the antics up above us. So it was great. It was quite a week, and so that's what we've done. But I will bring those.
Wow.
I'll share those pamphlets and stuff next week.
Okay. Any other business? Hearing done.
To adjourn.
Second.
Except to sign.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.